Did you say greeting?
Number five.
Number five, right off the bat, number five. Okay. Let's see. Five, 1.3. Okay, so this is the worksheet that you should still have, right, is all about two-dimensional figures. This is about a three-dimensional figure where the volume and the surface area are equal to each other, the values, right? Not the units, right? Now this is different. What, like, how do we measure surface area? What do we measure it with?
Squares.
Squares, right. Area is squares. How do we measure volume? Cubic squares, yeah, okay, or just cubes, right? Because this has to fill a three-dimensional space, so we need a shape with three dimensions, right? It needs to go up and out, back and left and right, all over three dimensions. So a cube is what we use to measure a volume. So a square cannot be equal to a volume, but we could say one square and one cube, right? So if a figure happened to have one square's worth of surface area and one cube's worth of volume, then well, its area would be equal to its volume. I use air quotes around that. Right? So we have this wooden box here. Okay, this length they call x. Here we got 5 inches tall and back here 6 inches wide. Okay. So let's write an equation for the volume. How would I write an equation for the volume of these dimensions, Sean?
5 times 6 times x.
5 times 6 times x. Okay. How about the surface area? A little bit trickier. Not sure, might help you for me to point out that this face and this face back here are
the same.
The same, yeah, they are both the same. This side and this back side over here are the same, the top and the bottom, all the same. Right? How many faces do we have surface areas on?
Six.
Six of them, so we have to add them all up, right? Let's start with this top side. What's the area of this top side?
6 times x.
6 times x is this length here. We have it. How many of those?
Two.
Faces? Two. Mm-hmm. So 2 times 6 times x. Yeah. We're gonna have to add on some more surface area, right? Someone give me some surface area, Sean.
2 times 5 times 6.
So 5 times 6, that's going to give me this area, right? So
yeah.
5 times 6 times 2, because there's 2 of those, plus, somebody else give me the last one. Ready?
2 times 5 times x.
Okay, and what face is that going to give me the area of?
This side one.
This side over here?
Yeah.
This side right here?
Yeah.
That and that one would be the other one that's harder to multiply by 2. 2 times 5x. Okay, well let's clean up this area formula because it certainly could be a lot cleaner. The area equals, so this is 2 times 6 times x, that would be 12x, and 5 times 6 times 2, that would be 30 times 2, that would be 60, plus 2 times 5x, that would be 10x, 12x plus 10x, you put those two together and get what?
22x,
and then plus 60, and that would be it. Okay, and the statement from the instructions say that the area and the volume, the numbers, are equal to each other. So here is, you know, if I knew what x was, I could plug it in, and that could tell me what the area was. I could plug it in here, figure out what the volume was. I'm going to go ahead and write this as 30x, of course. Grady, thoughts?
Well, wouldn't you put 22x plus 60 on the left side, and then equal sign, and then 30x?
Twenty-two x plus 60 equals 30x. Now we have this equation where catches. There's variables on both sides. We talked about how to remedy that. Someone besides Sean, besides Grady, besides Monica. Yes.
We subtract 22 x from each side.
Okay. Let's see. What's 22 x minus 22 x? Okay, that leaves just 60 on this side. Equals 30x minus 22x?
8x.
All right, how do we solve for x?
Divide by 8.
Okay, so x equals 7. See that there's no requirement that you have memorized any formulas. You can do all of this by understanding, right? Like, let's talk about this volume thing, because we haven't expressly talked about it, but I know you guys have talked about volume in other settings, okay? So let's go back to area. What is area?
The number of squares of Phillips shape.
Number of squares of Phillips base shape, a two-dimensional shape, like a flat shape, right? Like the surface of this tablet here, this board there, or whatever, flat thing, okay? So if the number of squares that fit in this space is what we call the area, then what's the volume?
The number of cubes that fill up the space.
Cubes that fill up the space. So if I want to figure out what the volume is, I want to figure out how many cubes fit in a space. So if I draw a simpler shape, with specific measurements here. Let's say this side is 3, and this side is 7, and this side is 2. Okay? Well, first we could look along the bottom side, just putting dotted line here for these sides. Then we could get these edges that we can't see. So let's just look at the bottom part, just the bottom. How many squares can fit in the bottom part of this box?
21.
Right? Three is the measurement on this side. Seven is the measurement on this side. So here is one square. Right? One square can fit right there, which would naturally mean that seven squares could be fit along there. And there's room enough for three of those rows of seven. We can fit 1, 2, 3 rows of 7 squares. So 21 squares fit along the bottom. Let's kind of draw that out. And let's pretend like that is showing that we have 21 squares. So it's very... 21 squares fitting along the bottom. All right. Now let's look in this direction, vertically. See the square here? Okay. So that's, there's one unit this way, one unit this way, and then one unit now in the other direction. So what's this here? What's that thing I just drew?
Cube.
One cube can fit right there because there's one square, right? Right there. And if I can extend it one unit in this third direction, this third dimension, then there's room enough for one cube, right? Well, this goes up 2, so there's room enough for 2 cubes, right? So like for every square on the bottom, how many cubes will there be?
One. Oh.
two cubes. For every square along the bottom, since this box is 2 inches, let's say, 2 inches tall, for every square, there will be how many cubes?
Two.
So if there's 21 squares on the bottom, and for every square you can stack 2 cubes on it, then how many cubes fit inside this box?
42
cubes. Okay. You see how I don't need to know any formulas? I don't need to memorize anything. I just need to know what volume is, and it is the number of cubes. Okay? And we can go from our area understanding right into volume. Right? Because once I put that third dimension on there, I just say, well, for every square on the bottom, right, I'm going to get 2 cubes to stack on top of that. So there's twice as many cubes as there are squares. So you didn't need to know a formula. You may have used one, but you didn't need to know it. You just need to know what volume is. It's the number of cubes. We counted the number of cubes as 30x. Setting all that up, 7.5 inches. All right. A question about something else, Sean?
8.
Number 8. Oh, wrong way. 8. Looks like. Okay, well, truth be told, I didn't realize this was going to be no solutions, but we can make sense of it. -2x. Plus 10 equals -2 times
x
plus 5. Okay. So, this is similar to the kind of equation we saw, in the previous section. So, what are your instincts telling you to start with? Somebody new. Somebody new. I've got Josie and Johnny there.
The distributive property?
Yeah, whenever we see something multiplied by parentheses, let's go ahead and distribute that thing into the parentheses. So we get -2x plus 10. And after we're done with this distribution, then we're going to take what we've learned about variables on both sides and give that a try. So, now what? We have variables on both sides. We kind of dealt with this a little bit, so we try what? Great.
Or you can do -10 on both, or -10 to -10 on that side.
Always both sides, right? Yeah, both sides. -10 on both sides, and we'll just see what happens. -10. So on this side, we have -2x plus what?
Zero.
There's plus 10, minus 10, 0. Okay. Equals, so this side we have -2x minus what?
20.
-10 minus 10 is -20. Okay. Now what? Now we still have variables on both sides.
What you would do is you would actually end up adding the two variables in this case instead.
Well,
I don't know.
Here, let's go back to the previous equation that we had and see what we did about variables on both sides. What did we do about variables on both sides?
We subtracted.
Subtracted what? How many x's from both sides? 22. Now we subtracted 22x. Why didn't we subtract 30x?
Because there was no numbers on that side.
It would give us a negative.
What's that?
It would give us a negative.
Give us a negative, okay, we give us a negative 8x plus 60 equals 0. Josie says there's no numbers on the side of 30x. Well, when we subtract 22x, right, then what happens on the left side of the equation? What do we wind up having happen here?
Just 60.
Just 60. No variables, right?
Yep.
Just number, right? But that's what we want when we solve an equation, is a number on one side. When we do this, we wind up with a number on one side and no x's. That's how we like it. X on one side, variables on the other, or x on one side, numbers on the other. That's how we figure out what x is. So when we subtract 22x from both sides, we leave 60 by itself and we wind up with just x's on the other side. That's exactly what we like. We like to have x's over here, numbers over here. Now we can divide and figure out what x is. Okay. So when we go to this next equation here, well, look, there's this negative 20 over here. We would like to not have an x over here with this number, right? So how are we going to get rid of this negative 2x? Fire it out there. Go.
Plus 2x.
Add 2x, right? If I add 2x to this negative 2x, I need to do that to the other side as well. So I do this because I don't want this here, right? But that winds up giving us 0 equals negative 20, does it?
No.
Does 0 equal negative 20?
No.
No.
Is that equation true?
No.
What is it?
No.
Not true. If it's not true, it's... What's the opposite of true?
False.
False. It's a false statement. 0 is negative 20. It isn't. We know that. 0 is not negative 20. 0 is 0. Negative 20 is negative 20, and there's no universe where they could equal each other. So, what does that mean about, like, the solution to this equation would be a value for x? Is there any value for x that would make this equation true?
No.
Maybe if we back up, maybe if we go back to this equation before we messed everything up, is there something I could plug in for x that would make both sides true?
No.
Why not?
Because if you do it to one side, you have to do it to the other, which it will equal the same thing if you plug it in for x. But one side also has a negative 20 or an extra number.
Okay.
So those two would just cancel each other out.
So this number, whatever I plug in for x, I'll get something here, right?
Yeah.
But what will I get here?
The same thing.
The same exact number, right? But on the right side, what you're saying is we also would subtract 20 from that number. So we get a number, the exact same number minus 20. Can the number ever be equal to itself minus 20? No. So there's just no way to plug a number in for x that would make this equation true. It will never be true. So what values of x work?
None.
None. So the value of x that works is called? Well, the number that you could plug in for x that would work, if there was one that worked, would be called the solution. But there isn't one, so there's no solution. There's no way to find an x that makes this equation work. It can't work. Never, never will. No solution. Great. Other questions? Monica?
Six.
Over there.
M minus 4 equals 2m.
M's on one side of the equation, numbers on the other side of the equation, so we want, well, one of these sides to have all the variables and one side to have all the numbers.
Subtract M from both sides.
Subtract M from both sides. That seems like a great idea on the left side because we won't have any M's with the numbers, okay? Just one side will have numbers on it. It's pretty convenient because what's 2M minus M?
1M.
1M. There's no dividing necessary at this step. Just m is negative 4. All right. Well, let's pass in our homework and at the same time clear our desks and get a piece of paper out. All right, so here we have this first one, number 1. The basic idea of having variables on both sides. And so there's a lot of things we could do first. There's definitely something that I would do first. What did you do first, Sean?
I subtracted 5x
from both sides. Okay, now you subtracted 5x from both sides. Why didn't you subtract 8x from both sides?
Because if I subtracted 8x, then it would leave with me with the negative 3x on one side.
All right, it would be negative instead of positive. No, don't misunderstand. Still we get the same solution. Still be a valid way of going about solving this equation. But I do like when the x's have a positive number in front of them. It's nice to work with. Okay, your solution may still be negative, but it's just easier to work with. So now we have at least variables only on one side, right? So who's next? Joseph.
You add 9 to both sides.
Add 9 to both sides. So we get 15 equals 3x. Great.
Divide 3 on both sides.
Divide 3, and x is 5. Okay, good. All right, number 2, what are your, what's your gut telling you you should start with? Yeah.
Distributing the
3. All right, so 4, x plus 3. Okay, now this looks a whole lot like this first equation. What should we do now? Grady?
Minus 4x on both sides.
Okay, so if I subtract 4x from 4x, I'll get 0. If I subtract 4x from 3x, I get? Negative 1x, very good. So negative x on this side, minus 21, equals 3. Now what? Side Sean, side Grady, side Josie, Blake.
Add
21 to both sides, so we'll get 24 equals negative x. Grady?
We divide by negative 1x for x on both sides.
Negative, divided by negative x?
By 1.
Yeah, 1. If I divide by negative x, what's negative x divided by negative x?
Negative 1.
One, it's something divided by exactly itself, right? That's always one. Negative x divided by negative x would just be one, and that's gonna cause a whole bunch of problems. All I wanna do is get a positive x, right? And divided by negative one would do that. Multiply by negative one would do that. But we'll divide by negative one on both sides, so x is what?
Negative 24.
All right, very good. Okay. Let's take this sheet out. I'm gonna help you out with part E. Okay, now E, F, and G are all very similar. And if you recall from working on this yourself, what is similar about E, F, and G? Different from A, B, C, and D?
They have an extra shape add on the side.
So we've got multiple rectangles in one figure. Okay, and I need this real quickly, so we'll put it over here. It's 2, 1, x, and 3. We need an area for the, or a formula for the area and for the perimeter. Okay? So let's talk about the perimeter first, okay? Because this is so strange with this extra shape over here, let's label all the sides, okay? So like, how long is this side?
X.
Here's X. How long is this side?
1.
How do you know it's 1?
Because if that square up there is 2, then that extra space must be 1 to make it equal. To make it
look a little bit more like it was 2. Well, this whole side is 3, this is 2, so there would be 1 for that. Okay, so let's look at the perimeter. The perimeter is the distance all the way around. If I were to walk around it and measure that distance, that's what the perimeter would be, right? So let's just start with here. So we have 2, and we walk this way. How far is that?
1.
Okay, so far the perimeter is 2 plus 1, okay, plus
one.
This side, 1, another 1, okay, plus
x,
plus this side, plus this. Plus this, right, plus x plus another 1. If you start here and go counterclockwise, you'll see why this is what it is, right? A side of 2, then 1, then 1, then x, then 3, then x, and then another 1. And then we're back where we started. We'll clean this up to be, let's see, x plus x is 2x. 2, 3, 4, 7, 8. 2x plus 8. And the area is going to be the area of this rectangle, and this rectangle, what? And the area of those two rectangles, or I do what with them to find the area of the whole thing?
Add them together.
What's the area of this small rectangle here?
2.
2 by 1. 2 squares can fit inside that little rectangle. 2 plus what's the area of this guy? 3 times x, whatever x is. All right. 2 plus 3x, 2x plus 8. Area, perimeter, what's special about this shape? Its area and its perimeter. They are equal to each other. So 2 plus 3x equals 2x plus 8. You solve that equation, which is very much like the one we just solved in the quiz, right, on the review. So you're going to find very similar situations here on those last two figures. The remainder of your homework, let's see, up to 15, well, 13 and 15 are essentially just solving equations that are given to you. The rest are going to require you to read and interpret what's being said, write an equation, and solve that equation. Okay? That's it for 1.3. That should be pretty well versed in solving equations that have variables on both sides. I'm just getting so the variables are on one side, numbers on the other.